Transmission begins.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
This is the Josh Tolley Show on the GCN Radio Network.
Sex trafficking. Sex trafficking is one of those topics that once in a while gets mentioned. Most people don't understand the size and the scope of it. And then when the Super Bowl comes around, there are stories that the Super Bowl is a hotbed for sex trafficking, which, of course, the media, which makes untold amounts of money on the Super Bowl, says, no, ain't happening around us. But that's not entirely the case. And to talk about this, we have Nita Bellis. She is the managing director for a nonprofit called In Our Backyard and the regional director for Central Oregonians Against Trafficking Humans, or OATH for short. Nita, welcome to the show. How are you doing?
Well, thank you for having me, Josh. I'm doing well. We've got another Super Bowl in the books.
We do. And, of course, the media says there's no sex trafficking associated with the Super Bowl. What say you?
I say I just got back from there, and there absolutely is, and there absolutely is an increase. We set up a command post about a week before Super Bowl and monitored it and worked with law enforcement, and there was absolutely an increase. Traffickers look for a place to make money. That's really what they're about. They're not about sex. They're about money.
Right.
And sex happens to be what sells. And so they are there looking for where the money is. You've got tens of thousands of men who have come into the area. They have paid a lot of money for a ticket to go see a game. They're there to party. They're there to have a good time. It's the boys will be boys, and the what happens at Super Bowl stays at Super Bowl mentality. And absolutely, there is an increase in sex trafficking. It may not be, it probably isn't the largest human trafficking event in the world. They don't bring in tens of thousands of victims, but there is a tremendous increase in human trafficking.
And I think to the normal-minded people, this is something we just don't get. Because when I go to a football game or hockey game or any sort of sporting event, I don't think to myself, well, I need the grill, I need some hot dogs, I need some rape, and then I also need, you know, some beer or something.
Right.
Like, a lot of us don't understand how this is even... how they relate.
Right. Well, and it is a small portion of our society who participates in the demand. They are the ones who buy human flesh for their own enjoyment and believe that paying for an hour of someone's time requires that person to do whatever they'd like in whatever way. But that, unfortunately, is more common than we think. The hits that an ad will get are huge. I mean huge. Like, they get hundreds of hits.
Wow. That's so sick and sad. So, okay, so let me ask you this. I mean... the NFL has taken a stand publicly against domestic abuse after the whole Ray Rice thing and a bunch of other incidences. Have they come out against this issue at all? Are they helping prevent sex trafficking? Are they ignoring it? What's the NFL's position on this?
Well, the NFL is definitely not saying we're for sex trafficking, but they
right.
have not come out like they've come out on domestic violence. They, in my opinion, they need to come out and say, we will not tolerate this. They don't have to implement the Super Bowl, because the Super Bowl is not the only sporting event
right.
or large event that human trafficking increases. Human trafficking increases for political conventions. Lots and lots of conventions, sporting conventions, fishing, anything that there is a large number of males with excess cash and a party atmosphere. That'll do it right there.
I would have never thought fishing, like ever would I have thought a fishing expo. So when we're talking about when we're talking about sex trafficking, we're not talking about people who voluntarily get into the sex trade. We're talking about kids that are kidnapped and all that sort of stuff, right?
That is true. There is a small percentage of victims because I believe they are victimized whether they're in it intentionally or not, but there are a small number of people who are prostituting themselves.
Sure.
That is a very small number, and the majority of those have been sex trafficked at a young age. Let's say a college kid decides she's going to sell herself for sex because she knows she can make money. Well, that is a slippery slope. Unfortunately, there are college kids that are choosing that. There's also another thing going on with the college kids, which has become very prevalent over the last couple years, called sugar babies and sugar daddies.
Yeah, 700,000 girls right now in college are selling sex for money through websites that promote sugar babies. And, you know, it's interesting that there is that aspect of it. And some people say, well, when you're talking about sex trafficking, you're talking about those people who are making a choice to go into that industry. But like you said, that's a small percentage, and that's not really what we're talking about. We're talking about people who are in this against their will. And why is it that Americans are so slow to recognize the magnitude of this problem?
Right. And if I can go back just a minute on the sugar babies and those who are choosing to sell themselves, that is a very slippery slope.
Oh, yeah.
And so what happens when somebody of that age and that desirability begins that slippery slope of saying, oh, I can make a couple $100 tonight, then we have predators who know that there are girls that will start in like that, and they look for them, and they will soon come to them and say, you know, you need someone to protect yourself out here. This is dangerous. And before they know it, they are now victims of sex trafficking. So that it was my point with the sugar babies and with the girls that are starting on their own. And then the older people, let's say late 20s, 30s, and even older, who are out there, once they kind of are used up in the system, then they may prostitute themselves only because they've been doing it for years as a trafficking victim, and they don't know anything else. There's no place else virtually for them to go. So back to your question about why does society not get on this and...
Well, actually, Nita, we're up against a break, so let's just hold that answer to the other side. But it is a question that I don't totally understand. Maybe it's just naivete. Maybe we don't think about it. And I also want to talk about where do some of these victims come from, because I think that'll shock a lot of people, too. So we'll be back right after this. All right, Nita, before the break, we were talking about the magnitude of this problem, how many Americans don't think that this is a problem in America. Yeah, maybe the Eastern European bloc countries and Asia or something, but not here in America. One, how big is this problem? Two, why don't most Americans know about it? Three, where do most of these underage girls come from?
The problem is epidemic, and people don't know about it because we don't like to talk about those things. We don't like to talk about things that are that sad, that horrific, that big of an atrocity. And so I believe that's why we don't like to talk about it, which plays right into the hands of the traffickers, because that's all they ask. That's all they ask of us, is that we just not talk about it. We don't admit that it's here, and then they can keep on doing what they're doing.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, what was the third part of the question?
Well, where are a lot of these girls coming from? Are these girls that are being raised in Iowa, or are these girls being trafficked in from some other nation? Who are the victims?
Yes, yes, yes. They are being raised primarily in the United States. I have never met a minor sex trafficking victim who was not an American-born citizen. The large majority of sex trafficking victims in our nation are American-born citizens. We often think about it as some Russian girls brought in, or Asian girls, or Mexican girls brought in to a brothel, and that does happen, but that's the minority. The large majority are kids, just normal kids in the United States, that have gotten lured into it. In the first chapter in my book, I talk about a girl we call Sarah. Sarah was a 16-year-old girl. She came from an upper-middle-class home, her parents' marriage intact. They were devout Christians. She was active in her youth group, and she met a girl at school who was recruiting for a pimp. And this girl befriended Sarah. She brought her clothing that her mother wouldn't let her wear. Sarah kept it in her locker at school and enticed her into this. And then she introduced Sarah to a pimp, and that pimp, within 3 months, Sarah went missing. And she was gone for a year. Sarah was one of the very fortunate ones, because after a year, the brothel that she was then being trafficked in Las Vegas, police did a raid on it, and Sarah wanted out. And she has gotten the help that she needed and moved on. But that is an extremely good news story compared to what happens. Most of these kids are American-born kids. Somebody who's a foster child or more at risk, coming from a tough family where there may be drugs or sexual abuse, they are at even higher risk.
You know, I've been covering this for a while. I've worked with some other organizations to bring light to this issue, and it always amazes me how large this problem is. And, you know, some of the myths, too. Like, a lot of people think that this is just young girls. Boys are victims as well, correct?
Exactly. Yeah, not as often as girls.
Sure.
They do get victimized, though, and usually in a little different way. The boys are usually victimized in part because they have come out as LGBTQ in that domain. That is more of an issue with the boys, but it also is an issue with the girls. Boys are made to perform in different ways in different venues. It's a little different animal, if you will, than the girls who are sex trafficked. In some ways, the boys, although the girls are really brutally treated, the boys are even more brutally treated.
How big is this problem? How many kids right now are being held in this sort of environment?
We don't really have numbers because, as you can imagine, it's hard. People don't stand up to be counted for this. But the estimate is that 250,000 American citizens are trafficked each year. And it's hard to know. Those of us who work in this every day believe that it is higher than that.
Is the problem getting worse or is it getting better?
It's hard to say. There are some things that are happening that are better. One of the things that is happening now is that we've got more awareness due to people like you and others who are talking about this, making the public aware. So there are more reports, and I don't know if it's gotten more prevalent or if there are just more reports. There's no way to really prove that. there are more services beginning to happen. We need more services. There's research that's starting to be done. Sadly, the research is behind the eight ball because we've got so much that needs to be researched in order to give the best services, in order to take care of people in the most honoring way that we can, in most efficient way, most healing way.
So Nita, who tracks this? Who comes up with the numbers of how bad this is, or if there's improvement being made? Because obviously I've talked to the FBI on the numbers they have, and of course it's atrocious. But is there like an organizing body that's grouping together these efforts like yours to fight this?
Yeah, you know, I think the most, quote, organizing body, I would say, in the United States would be the Polaris Project.
Yeah.
They have the National Human Trafficking Hotline contract, and they are the ones that take the majority of the calls about human trafficking here in the United States. They do a lot of referrals. They have organized a network of people who are doing it. For instance, I'm on their list of people that can help you. And so they are probably the best place, and they are the people I refer to when somebody has a question, when somebody is in need of help. If I don't have a direct referral for them, I'll refer them to the National Human Trafficking Hotline.
So what can we do? I mean, obviously, you know, most of us just live our lives oblivious to this. What can we do to prevent it, stop it, fight back against it?
Well, the first thing people can do is talk about it. Again, that's all the traffickers ask us not to do. That's the first thing we can do, talk about it to others. Have you heard about this? I heard a radio show. If everyone that hears this show tells three people what they heard, they've just done something. I would also recommend learning more, and I am shameless about referring to my book because I put the best information I knew in there about human trafficking. Go to Amazon, get In Our Backyard, go on my website. There's another thing we do called freedom stickers. You can place those in bathroom stalls, and those can be the ticket to getting somebody out of being trafficked, because within about 2 minutes of being inside a restroom stall, which is usually the only time that a victim of sex trafficking is not being watched, the trafficking victim can see that number inside the stall.
Yeah.
Dial 233-633 on their cell phone, and they can get a plan for safety, a plan for help, erase that text before they leave the bathroom stall.
And Nita, hold on one second. We're up against a break. We're going to continue this on the other side. All right, Nita, before we get back into this, can you give everybody your website, please?
You sure can. It's www.inourbackyard.org.
Absolutely. And I also want to mention again the Polaris Project, which is polarisproject.org, too, which you mentioned earlier, so folks can have that as well.
Right.
Now, Nita, a couple things that come up with this is this idea that somehow if we legalize prostitution, that human trafficking goes down, and that's not the case. There was a study done by a university in Germany, and they found that it actually goes up. It actually increases human trafficking on average about 13.4%. And they believe part of that is due to the fact that now you have this almost illicit activity, and just like a drug, now you want something more, something else. And of course, nobody's legalizing sex with 15-year-old girls or 14-year-old boys, so that becomes an even higher market. Matter of fact, human trafficking generates a lot more per individual being used, I guess, than legal prostitution. But what do you say to people who say, oh, well, this is all because we're not legalizing prostitution. Legalize prostitution, this problem goes away.
Oh, yeah. That is a huge myth.
Yeah.
And generally, perpetuated by people who either don't know or do participate. And so science shows and studies have shown that anytime you have what's called a quote-unquote legal sex industry, that human trafficking increases. And so you can have a lot of, like, for instance, Portland, Oregon has been called the largest per capita sex industry in the United States. And any time you have legal sex industry, it breeds the human trafficking side of things, because it's created an environment that selling sex is okay. And then they bring in the young girls, they bring in a lot of people that are trafficked for different reasons. And as you mentioned, also adults. There are adults that are trafficked, and they are no less trafficked than a 13-year-old girl. If they are controlled by a trafficker, which I don't like to call them pimps because our society has glamorized that word, but if they are controlled by a pimp or trafficker, then they are a victim of human trafficking. And make no mistake, that trafficker gets 100% of the money. He controls everything.
Right. And I think that's a huge distinction, because we have a fairly large liberty-minded audience, and there's always a debate going on about should prostitution be legal, like in places like Nevada, and healthcare checks on sex workers. But that is not what we're talking about. And like we referenced, even in places where those things are made legal, human trafficking actually gets worse, not better. So what about those people who speak out against this? Now, there are reports that once you do, you get threatened or maybe killed. We know that I had one former, victim talking about how they would threaten her partner. So they would pair her up with somebody and say, hey, if you run, we kill Janet. So what's the risk of speaking up about this?
Well, for a victim, the risk is you risk your life, you risk the life of your loved ones. If somebody is being victimized, is being trafficked, and they decide that they want to speak up or that they want to run, I have heard stories of the victim who is trying to get out being beaten to death in front of other victims to say, this is what happens if you try to run.
Yeah.
I own you. I've seen their parents' houses burnt down where a victim tries to run and all of a sudden they find out, hey, your parents' house burnt down last night.
Yeah.
Try it again. And so, yeah, they don't really have, it's not like they're free to leave even though they're out in public like everyone else. There are tremendous threats, and they're not just threats. I often have the question, well, would they carry the threats out, or are they real threats? Oh no, they will carry the threats out, and brutally.
Well, that's because we're talking about a massive industry. I mean, the business side of this, for those people who are doing the trafficking, we're talking about billions of dollars.
Absolutely. And I'm glad you said the business side of it. It's not that it's a legitimate business, but that's how the pimps, that's how the traffickers look at it, as though it's the business. That's why they go to Super Bowl, because there's money there. It's just like if I own a carpet cleaning industry and we have a flood, I'm going to profit because I'm going to use my equipment and make more money.
Right.
They view human trafficking the same way you would view any other business, and they are brutal about capitalizing on misfortune, on natural disasters. Anytime we have a natural disaster, we know human trafficking will go up because the perpetrators say there are people that are vulnerable, that have needs, and I will go in and capitalize on that and traffic them, and I'll make money.
You mentioned something interesting, and I want to bring this up too, especially because this hasn't happened yet for the 2016 year, and that's the political conventions, the Democrat National Convention, the Republican National Convention. Why do we see an increase of sex trafficking when these are the people who are coming together to try to make America better, and they all want to stand on a moral platform? I mean, Nita, come on. Shouldn't this be where there is no trafficking at all?
Shouldn't it be that way? Yes, it should be that way, but it is not that way. The incident of trafficking goes up tremendously.
Yeah. Yeah. So give us a little hope. Give us a success story or two before we have to let you go. You got about 2 minutes.
Okay. Well, the success stories are many, but they're a small percentage. But let me tell you about about friends that I have who have been victims in sex trafficking and are now out and healthy. I have a friend in Utah who runs a house for survivors. She was sex trafficked for a lot of years, and she is now out. She's helping others. She needs support. She needs help to continue to do that. They're always low on food and low on resources, but she's doing everything she can, and she's making a difference. She's pulling others out of human trafficking who are being trafficked, and they have a safe place to go where they know somebody understands. There are other survivors who are living very successful lives. I have a friend by the name of Wendy Barnes who has a book out who will tell you exactly in that book how it happened, and it's called And Life Continues. But she was trafficked for 13 years, has three children by her trafficker, ended up spending time in prison herself, but today she is living a successful life, and she is helping others. So there are a lot of success stories.
I love redemption stories.
By a lot of pain.
I love redemption stories. I love redemption stories because I know that there are going to be victims watching this later on YouTube once it's off the broadcast, the radio broadcast. I know that there are even going to be perpetrators who have taken part in this. You can stop. You can shift courses and go the other direction, can't you?
Absolutely, absolutely. And, you know, I have more hope for a trafficker to turn around than I do for a perpetrator of domestic violence. I've seen that more often. So, yes, they can turn around. Yes, they can go the other direction.
Well, Nita, I want to say thank you for taking the time today to address this issue. I know everybody was excited yesterday with the Super Bowl and all that sort of stuff. And that's fun, you know, whatever. But when there are so many people who are victims, we have to give that time to, and that's exactly what you did. Thank you, Nita.
Well, thank you, Josh. I appreciate you doing that as well.
All right, folks, that does it for today. Keep talking about it. Keep talking about it. Don't let this be the end. While you're at work or when you get home or whatever you're doing next, talk about it. Say, hey, I just listened to this show. You don't even have to plug me. Don't even make it about me. I just listened to this show. They were talking about sex trafficking. Look into it. Google it. All that sort of stuff. Because the more we talk about it, that's step number one in this war. All right. Remember, no victim, no crime. Look into jury nullification. Today, tomorrow, as always, my friends, may your path lead to heaven and may freedom follow in your footsteps. Hey, thanks for watching. If you loved what I had to say, then subscribe right here. If you hated what I had to say, subscribe right here. It's fun being mad on social media, isn't it? Either way, I'd love to hear from you. Send me an email right there.